Good evening to all of you and a warm welcome to our catechesis session. We begin by signing ourselves with the sign of the cross in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You who dwell in the shelter of the Most High, who abide in the shadow of the Almighty, will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust, for he will deliver me from the snares of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence. He'll cover me with his pinions, and under his wings he will find refuge. His faithfulness is a shield and a buckler. Shall not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in darkness, nor the destruction that wastes at noonday. 1,000 may fall at our side, 10,000 at our right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only look with your eyes and see the recompense of the wicked. Because you have made the Lord your refuge, the Most High your habitation. No evil shall befall you, no scourge come near your tent, for he has given his angels charge over you to guard you in all your ways. On their hands they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You will tread on the lion and the adder, the young lion and the serpent. You will trample underfoot. Because he clings to me in love, I will deliver him. He will protect me because I know his name. When I call to him, he will answer me. He will be with me in trouble. He will rescue me and honor me with long life. He will satisfy me and show me his salvation. Amen. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Psalm 121, I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not let my foot be moved. He who keeps me will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is my keeper. The Lord is my shade. On my right hand, the sun shall not strike me by day nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep us from all evil. He will keep our life. The Lord will keep are going out and are coming in from this time forth and forevermore. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Saint Michael the Archangel, defend us in the day of our battle. Be our safeguard against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all other evil spirits who roam throughout the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Saint Francis of Assisi, pray for us. Saint Clare of Assisi, pray for us. Our Lady of Immaculate Conception, pray for us. Good evening to all of you and a warm welcome once again to our session, catechesis session on purgatory. Yesterday we completed about purgatory. We stopped at indulgences. So the means to assist the souls in purgatory are indulgences. We've seen somewhat the basic thing. Today, I'm just going to go back again to that as a refresher so that all those who may have not heard it or may have not understood will understand very clearly what indulgence exactly is. So first and foremost, that this is the official teaching of the church. I mean, you and I are in no position to say we disbelieve it. Indulgences are a part of the infallible teaching. That means which cannot make error. The complete truth, that means it is the teaching of the church. It has not been disposed of. So indulgences are very much valid, as much as it was valid right from the time given. Okay. So right in the middle centuries, in the medieval period, where there was a discredit due to Martin Luther and the other, his followers who discredited the indulgences due to various reasons and due to various practices. But we know very clearly that it is the infallible or the absolute teaching of the church, the correct teaching of the church. Okay. So we are bound to believe without error. We are bound to believe. Okay. So we cannot disbelieve in it. Now, I will quote to you from the Catechism of the Catholic Church. Okay. So I'm going to quote to you from the Catechism of the Catholic Church, because all our doctrine and teaching comes from there, right? So what is an indulgence? So let us see, as I said yesterday, paragraph number 1471. Okay, paragraph number 1471 of the CCC. CCC stands for Catechism of the Catholic Church. An indulgence is a remission. Remission means cancellation, okay? Pardoning, cancellation before God of the temporal punishment. Temporal punishment due to sin. Temporal punishment due to sin whose guilt has already been forgiven. Whose guilt has already been forgiven. It's very important for us to know all these words because this is how we understand, or we will not understand the real meaning of indulgence. Okay, we have to understand this clearly. Indulgence is a remission before God, okay, of the temporal punishment due to sin, okay, whose guilt has already been forgiven, which the faithful Christian who's duly disposed gains under certain. So we have to be duly disposed to gain the indulgence. Yesterday also I mentioned that there should be a proper disposition. There are certain conditions which require. If we don't fulfill those conditions, we are not going to gain the indulgence. So let this be very clear to us. Certain conditions need to be fulfilled. Okay, that I'm going to tell you. What are the disposition? That means we need to be in the state of sanctifying grace. We have already discussed that yesterday. Okay. Duly disposed gains under certain prescribed conditions. So certain conditions need to be fulfilled. Unless those conditions are fulfilled, we will not gain. So very, very important. First is that it is a remission. First point. Second thing of what? Of the temporal punishment of the sin. Okay. Third thing, with the guilt already been forgiven. Now, let me explain all these points. Fourth point, duly disposed. I mean, it is applicable to the Christian, faithful Christian who is duly disposed. Now, hear the word faithful Christian. That means the Christian should be baptized. He should not be excommunicated. He should be in the state of sanctifying grace. That means he should not be in any state of mortal sin. Okay, in state of mortal sin. But now in this pandemic, we are in an extraordinary condition. So I'm going to discuss that also. So leave that aside right now. But look at the normal condition. If we were not in a pandemic and it's a normal condition, so we are talking in that scenario, what is the, how will the indulgence be applied? Okay, duly disposed under the prescribed conditions. Okay, through the action of the church. That means only the church has the power. So God has given the power to the church, action of the church. Okay, who is the minister of redemption, dispenses and applies the with the authority, the treasury. From the treasury, all the satisfaction. Treasury of the church. So there is something called as treasury of the church. Now, treasury of the church is not what they collect every Sunday, not our Sunday collection. That is not the meaning. It means the spiritual treasury. So there is a spiritual treasury of the church. All that Christ has done right from the time of incarnation till the mystery of his passion, death and resurrection. All those are called as the infinite merit. They have infinite merit. We can gain from every action of Christ, right from the time that he suffered as a child, right up to the time he suffered onto the death. That means born in a stable, born in a manger, born, you know, without any, I mean, without any people to respect him, to honor him, except the shepherds and then the three kings. But, you know, everybody rejected him. And then, so all the sufferings and hardships that he and Mother Mary, along with that, also the treasury that is gained by our Blessed Virgin Mother and all the saints, but they all gain that merits only through Christ, only through Jesus Christ. We have to understand this thing. Okay. So I hope we understand this. So there are 7 points that it is remission. That means remission means it is what you call as a pardon. Okay. That means remission means a complete, you know, a pardon for the sin of what? Temporal punishment. Now, as I told you yesterday, sin has consequences. Sin has consequences. First is that sin has a guilt. With every sin, there is a guilt. So we are going to come to that. Okay. We are going to discuss all this. We are going to discuss the temporal punishment. We are going to discuss the guilt forgiven. Okay. So now it says that the guilt has to be forgiven. That means it presupposes we have to go to the sacrament of reconciliation. So unless we confess our sin, Indulgence is only applicable when we do a confession. If we don't do a confession, indulgence will not be applied. I'm talking in normal circumstances. Please understand very clearly. In normal circumstances. In normal circumstances, if we don't do a confession, the indulgence will not be applied. The indulgence will not be applicable to us. Okay. So understand this very clearly. So it requires sacrament of penance. So in the sacrament of penance, what happens? That this guilt is pardoned. So sin has two consequences. Eternal consequence, that means eternal punishment, which we gain. And second is temporal punishment. So the eternal punishment means which we would have gone to hell, that gets cancelled when we are truly repentant. Through the sacrament of penance, when we are truly repentant and we go and confess our sin, then this guilt is gone and this punishment also is gone. But there is a temporal punishment. Now that is not taken away. Unless sometime God permits, if we are truly sorry from our heart, then God definitely removes even that temporal punishment. If we are truly sorry from our heart, then sometimes on certain occasions, that is only in the power of God. Only God can decide. Okay. But most of the time, the temporal punishment is not taken away. Okay. So we have to bear that. Now, how do we know that? So I hope we understand. Indulgences are what? It is a remission. That means a complete negligence, or it is a pardon. Complete, you know, removal of the punishment due to what? Before God, of the temporal punishment. So it is talking only of temporal. It has got nothing to do with the eternal punishment, because indulgence is applied for temporal punishment. Eternal punishment is taken away through the sacrament of penance. Once we do sacrament of penance, we go for confession, the sin and the guilt and the eternal consequence wiped out. Okay, let this be clear. But indulgence is applied to the temporal punishment. Okay, so we can apply it, we can gain it for ourselves, or we can apply it to another soul. That means not to living people, but to people who are dead, to the souls in purgatory. Okay, we can apply it only to the souls in purgatory. We cannot apply it to anybody else, not to our family members. I mean, not to our living people. That means living people. Okay, so understand this way. We can gain it for ourselves or we can apply it. So two things are there. Gain it for oneself or apply it for any other departed soul. Departed soul. Okay, that can be in general. Any holy soul in purgatory or some of our family members who are departed. Right? Now the guilt has to be forgiven. Because if the confession is not properly done, then the indulgence also becomes invalid. I mean, it will not gain the merit. It will become partial. There are two types of indulgence. So that's why the guilt needs to be forgiven. So it presupposes, that means it expects that you have done the sacrament of penance. Then duly disposed. Duly disposed means what? You have to be, once you do confession, sanctifying grace comes into your heart. So you're duly prepared. Okay. And then you have the right intention. Your intention should be correct. That means you should have the intention to offer it for the souls in purgatory. Third, the prescribed conditions. There are certain conditions which are laid down by the church that we are going to see slowly ahead. And but it only happens due to the action of the church. That means only church has the authority to grant. Okay, the Roman Pontiff, that is the Holy Father, the successor of Saint Peter, he's called the Roman Pontiff. So the successor of Saint Peter, only he has the power to grant the, I mean, through the treasury, through the merits of the treasury of the church, he can grant the indulgence, not anybody and everybody. So we can't apply gain indulgence by ourselves. It is granted by whatever the Holy Father has granted, and it is mentioned down, as I told you yesterday, the book's name is called Enchiridion Indulgentiarium. Okay, so that book means the collection of enriched indulgence prayers. Which prayers are indulgence? Which works are indulgence? So I hope these 7 points are clearly understood. Okay, now paragraph number 1472 of the CCC. Now we'll move ahead. Today's session also might go a little longer. So please bear with me because I want to complete this topic completely. Paragraph number 1472. What does it say? Now, the punishment of sin. So listen carefully. To understand this doctrine and practice of the church, it is necessary to understand that sin, every sin, every mortal sin. Yesterday I described to you mortal sin and venial sin. So every sin, okay, has a double consequence. Okay, double consequence. What is that? Grave sin, that means mortal sin, grave sin, that is mortal sin, deprives us of the communion with God and therefore makes us incapable of eternal life. That means we are deprived of seeing God. So it makes us incapable of eternal life. So this is called eternal punishment or eternal consequence of sin. This is called eternal punishment. That means it makes us incapable of entering into heaven, eternal life, or and seeing the face of God. Okay, it's very simple to understand. On the other hand, every sin. So apart from this, even mortal sin, but not only mortal sin, even every venial sin has something very, it entails an unhealthy. That means with venial sin, we have an unhealthy attachment to creatures. We have an unhealthy attachment to creatures, which must be, that means to anybody. We may be attached to our family members. We may be attached to wealth, to our goods, to our, you know, all the works that we do. That is called unhealthy attachment. If we are unhealthily attached, that entails venial sin. Because true love means you should love God with all your heart, without any attachment. We should love other creatures for the sake of God. Not because we should be possessive of them, but rather we should love them for the sake of God. Otherwise, that is called unhealthy attachment. If we are attached to anybody in that way, it becomes unhealthy. That is called possessiveness or unhealthy. That's a sin in itself. Okay, so that also entails a venial sin. So on the other hand, even venial sin entails an unhealthy attachment to creatures, which must be purified. Where it can be purified? Either here on earth or after death. And that is called purgatory. So either here it on earth, if we have to allow it to be purified, we have to undergo all the punishment, or we'll have to purify it in the purgatory. This purification frees from what is called as temporal punishment. So this is called temporal punishment. So all the thing that God allows us to bear is called temporal punishment. So I hope this is clear. These two punishments should not be conceived as that God wants to inflict some kind of vengeance on us or punishment, but rather from the very nature of sin, because sin itself separates us from God. Now listen to this very carefully. A conversion which proceeds from a fervent charity, a conversion, that means through repentance, which proceeds from fervent charity. Now charity is not what we give alms. No, charity means your love of God. Love of God through charity. What Saint Paul talks to us in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Love is kind. Love is patient. Love. So that type of love. So love of God. So a charity can attain complete peace. So if we really have full love of God, sincere love of God, we can atone for all the sins immediately, instantly, because that means we should do it for the sake of love of God. Now I'll give an example. Today, one brother called me from our SFO only. His name is Brother Reginald. So he asked me, "Brother, what about the thief who asked Jesus? I mean, Jesus said, he said, remember me in this day with you in paradise. What happened to him?" So it's very important to understand the thief was really sorry. You can say that the plenary indulgence was applicable to him, because he knew that because of his sin, he deserved the punishment. So he's justifying that I am a sinner, and he rebukes the other person, saying that we deserve this punishment. But here this man is truly the Son of God, because he has done no wrong, yet he is crucified. So by that act of it, that means he loved God. He understood that Jesus is the Son of God. He accepts the punishment inflicted on him. So that is called, that's why our Lord said, "This day you will be with me in paradise." You can consider that as a cause of plenary indulgence. Immediately, by the merit of Christ's death and passion, he was taken into paradise. I mean, obviously, Jesus descended into limbo. And then later on, when Jesus rises, he will be with our Lord in paradise. That is the understanding. So very clear for us to understand that how our Lord pardoned. So when we have real love for God, I mean, nothing else should supersede the love for God. That is called true charity. That means nothing else, no other attachment to any creatures, nothing. That is called true charity. So such a charity can pardon all our sin. There will be no punishment for us. Right? Okay. Now the forgiveness of sin and restoration of communion, forgiveness of sin. So this sin needs to be forgiven. So eternal punishment gets cancelled when our sins are forgiven. And restoration of communion with God entails the remission of eternal punishment. So with this, eternal punishment gets cancelled when we do confession, when we are truly repentant. But the catechism teaches us temporal punishment remains. Temporal punishment remains. While patiently bearing the sufferings, okay, and trials of all kind, without complaining, without murmuring, without grumbling, without accusing, without blaming, without finding fault, when we patiently bear. We don't do that. Every day we go on complaining, we go on murmuring, we go on finding fault with everybody except ourselves. So these are not going to take us into heaven at all, because these are going to only take us down, down and down. So our sin will not get pardoned. But rather, when we bear all these things for the sake of love of God with a true intention, that point of time, it will take us, this temporal punishment also will get cancelled. So indulgence does this. Okay. He shall strive by works of mercy and charity. You know, the spiritual and corporal works of mercy. Feed the hungry, clothe the naked, and give the drink to the thirsty, and the spiritually instruct the ignorant, okay? As well as by prayer and the various practices of penance, to put off completely the old man and put on the new man. That means by this, we will be able to overcome our temporal punishment. So this is what indulgence does. So when we confess our sin, only this is gone. Only eternal punishment and the guilt is gone. But the temporal punishment is not wiped away unless we are truly sorry and we have true love of God. Until then, it is not. Most of the cases, it is not wiped out. Okay. So, because we are not rightfully having the right disposition or a proper understanding. Okay. So, I hope this is very clear. So, let us understand now this. So, this treasury of Christ is taught to us by the communion of saints. The communion of saints means that if any other member, that means the church triumphant, all those who are in heaven. So Catechism 1474, the Christian who seeks to purify himself of his sin and to become holy with the help of God's grace is not alone. So every person who tries to become holy is not alone. So who is there along with him? The life of each God's children, all God's children all over the earth, is joined in Christ and through Christ in a wonderful way to the life of all Christian brothers and sisters in a supernatural unity. That means this unity can't be seen by us. That is called mystical body of Christ. So what is the mystical body of Christ? The church triumphant in heaven, those who are saints, the church militant, which is struggling and fighting, pilgrim church, and the church suffering, which is in purgatory. We are all united. That is called mystical body of Christ. Okay, there is a perennial link, an eternal link of charity which exists between the faithful who have already reached the heavenly home. Okay, those faithful who are expiating their sins in purgatory, that means those who are atoning for their sins in purgatory, and those who are still pilgrims on earth. We are pilgrims on earth. Between them, there is an exchange of all the good things. So much so that the holiness of one, holiness of particular saints, profits the others, as well as the harm that the sin. So even our sin can harm others. Remember, sin is not a personal thing. Sin has social consequences also. The sin of one person, any person's sin in the SFO can affect all the other members also. Please understand. So this is how we are bound. So we have to understand this very carefully. So the course of to the communion of the saints lets the contrite sinner be more promptly and efficaciously purified of the punishment of sin. So this is called all these spiritual goods are collected in the treasury of the church. And from this, through the merits of Christ's passion, I already explained to you, all that is the treasury of the church, we can apply it to ourselves, right? So, I hope we have understood. Now, let us listen to this very important article, 1478. Article 1478 of the CCC. What does it say? An indulgence is obtained. How? Through the church. I already discussed this with you yesterday. By the virtue of the power of binding and loosing, because Jesus gave the power to Peter. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth, that means the priest has the power to not forgive your sins. He can reject to forgive our sins. If we are not truly repentant, he can, we have not heard this, but this was the practice certain decades ago. The priest would refuse to pardon the sins. Okay, intervenes. So, binding and loosening granted to her by Christ Jesus intervenes in favor of individual Christians and opens for them the treasury of the merits of Christ and the saints to obtain from the Father of mercy. That means we can gain from Abba Father the remission of the temporal punishment due for their sin. Thus, the church does not want simply to come to the aid, but to also spur them. That means to prompt us to works of devotion, penance, and charity. So not just, you know, to gain the indulgence, but rather we also should do acts of devotion, acts of penance, and acts of charity. So since the faithful departed, now purified, are also members of the same communion of saints, one way we can help them is to obtain. So because we are part of this mystical body, we can help the souls departed in purgatory so that their sins can be remitted. So I hope this is very clear to us that the temporal punishment, either of mine or of any other departed soul in purgatory, of all the holy souls in purgatory or poor souls in purgatory as they are called, can be remitted. So I can apply this indulgence. Now, how do we know this? The Holy Scripture speaks to us, okay, how the guilt is pardoned. Isaiah chapter 1 verse 18. How do we know that sins consequences are pardoned, the guilt is pardoned, okay, and the punishment is pardoned? So every sin has a punishment, eternal punishment and temporal punishment. So Isaiah chapter 1 verse 18, the word of God tells us something very, very important. What does it say? Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be, that means as red as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool. That means God will pardon our sin. Okay, this is very clear. Okay, now, so Sirach chapter 12 verse 14. Sirach chapter 12 verse 14. Okay, sorry, that scripture is not here. Okay, I will give you that word of God later on. That scripture is not here. Right? Now, we will turn to the temporal and eternal punishment. Now, remember, when God cursed Eve, what did he say? Both Adam and Eve and the serpent. He told Eve, Adam, he told you will, by the sweat of your brow, you will labor. That is called temporal punishment. So, with his confession, with his repentance, I mean, the guilt is pardoned. Okay, that means only after Jesus came, the guilt is pardoned. But the temporal punishment, and even for Eve, that means you will bear children with pain. So, that means that is called the temporal punishment. That is the meaning of temporal punishment. So, that's why the temporal punishment gets applied to us. So, temporal penalties remain. Though the sin is forgiven, God removes the guilt. Eternal punishment has been wiped out. Okay, but the temporal punishment remains. Like, for example, we see in 2 Samuel chapter 12. 2 Samuel chapter 12 verse 13 and 14. 2 Samuel chapter 12 verse 13 and 14. Now, here we see Prophet Nathan. What does he tell David? He tells David something. Right? He tells David something. David said to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. David confesses his sin. And Nathan said to David, Lord has put away your sin. He has put away your sin. You shall not die. Nevertheless, because by this deed you have utterly scorned the Lord, the child that is born to you shall die. That is the temporal punishment. The child that is born, and definitely the child died, as the Lord spoke through the mouth of Prophet Nathan, that is called temporal punishment. That is called the temporal. So sometimes our sicknesses also are due to sin. So many of these sins, though not all sicknesses are due to sin, but certain suffering, certain sicknesses are due to sin. They definitely have the temporal punishment due to sin. So God remits the temporal punishment. So expiation means we make amends. Making amends for the wrong that we have done. Okay. Proverbs 16 verse 6. Proverbs 16 verse 6. What does the scripture tell us? By loyalty and faithfulness, iniquity is atoned. That means how do we do expiation, or how? By loyalty and faith, by faithfulness to God, by being faithful, committed to our prayer, to our prayer life, to our devotion, okay, to the works of charity, to penance. All these things we are able to this thing. So what happens? So any indulgence first always wants that we have to do confession, because only through the confession, the guilt is removed. and the eternal punishment is wiped out. So these two goes away. So confession is required, remits the punishment. Okay, but as I said, we need indulgence to remove the temporal punishment. So Proverbs chapter 24 verse 16. Proverbs 24 verse 16. Why do we need indulgence? Because not only for those who are sinners, but even for the just man. Why? For a righteous man or a just man falls 7 times and rises again. So in a day, even a righteous man, the scripture tells us, even a person who is just in the sight of God falls 7 times a day. So forget about those who are conducting sin. But even a righteous man in the sight of God falls 7 times a day. So it is very clear to us that we can fall into sin. Okay, now coming to actually what these indulgences, I already explained to you what is indulgence. I told you from the Catechism of the Catholic Church, what does it mean? Now we are going to have something very, very important. We are going to discuss something very, very important now, what these indulgences are. So as I told you, there is something called manual of indulgences. You don't need to purchase it. You don't need to buy it. You don't need to download it. I'm going to explain to you only certain basic points which are required, which you need to know. If you wish, you can do it. It is available. Okay. So the manual is a reprint of what is called Enchiridion. Enchiridion means of indulgences. That means enriched prayers. All those prayers which are enriched by indulgence. I mean those prayers through which we can gain indulgence. So there is something. The fourth edition in the year 2000 for the year of Jubilee was printed, and it is called the Manual of Indulgences. Okay, now we are going to read a little bit on that. So I'm going to read and tell you about the Manual of Indulgences. What all is required. So first and foremost, we need, just a minute. Yeah. So what is an indulgence? We have already seen. Now, do indulgences forgive sins? Let me clarify certain doubts. Indulgence do not forgive any sin. No sin is forgiven by the indulgence. Please understand. It is always understood. It only remits the punishment. That means you have to already confess the sin. Okay, let this be very clear. Indulgence does not pardon any sin, but rather it will only remit, or it will remove, it will cancel the debt. Okay, so why does one need indulgence? Because the just man falls 7 times a day, the debt of justice that we pay to God. Now, how are we supposed to obtain an indulgence? Okay, what are the requirements? So one may obtain an indulgence by having, 1 minute, one may obtain the indulgence by having a proper, what do you call as being properly, a proper intention. You should have a proper intention first. Secondly, you should be properly disposed. Okay, these two conditions are very, very important. Please understand and listen very carefully. If one seeks, as I told you, there are two types of indulgence. One, what is called as plenary indulgence. Plenary, which means it cancels the entire punishment. It removes. And partial, which removes only the partial indulgence. Okay. So I hope this is very clear. A plenary, that means it removes the complete indulgence, and partial, which removes only the partial. So plenary indulgence is what? It is a complete remission of all temporal punishment. Okay. Temporal punishment due to sin. A partial indulgence frees the person from some temporal punishment, only part of it. Okay, so this should be very clear to us. Okay, now how does one obtain? So one needs to have a proper intention and properly dispose, and they should also, the third thing, you should properly perform the indulgence act, properly perform the task, or whatever indulgence act is there, one should perform that. So understand the three conditions. Proper intention, that means we should have a good intention that we need to gain the indulgence. We should be properly disposed, that means we should be in the state of grace. That means for being in a state of grace, what do we need to do? we need to go for sacramental confession. That means we need to go for confession. Then we need to receive Holy Communion. Okay? So these are called properly disposed. Okay? We should be properly disposed. And also, we should worthily receive the Holy Communion, not unworthily. People, I see that when they come to the church without doing a confession, if we are going for communion, we are conducting a very grave sin. That is called sacrilege. Receiving the body of Christ, body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, without doing confession, without examining our conscience, will only bring us worse punishment. That is called sacrilegious confession and sacrilegious communion. Sorry, sacrilegious communion. Because without having done a proper confession, if we are going and receiving our Lord, it is very dangerous. It will add to a greater punishment. It will add to a greater punishment. So unless we do a confession, we should not receive our Lord in an unworthy manner. Okay, so that's why it is called worthily receive Holy Communion. And then we should pray for the Holy Father's intention. So pray for the Holy Father. You know that there is a monthly intention. But we can only suffice that we should pray one Our Father and one Hail Mary. These two will suffice. Just praying for the Holy Father's intention. One Our Father, one Hail Mary. Okay. So now, and we should be free. We should be free from all attachment to sin, even venial. Now these conditions are what? These are applicable for plenary indulgence. This is very, very important. Please listen very carefully. To gain a plenary indulgence, we need to have a proper intention. That means we should have a proper right intention, good intention to gain it. Either to for ourselves or we should have the intention to apply it to the souls in purgatory. Please get this clear. Okay. Then properly disposed means we should do a confession so that the sin is pardoned. And then we should receive our Lord in a worthy manner on that same day. Now confession and communion. Though there are certain privileges granted, that means you can do confession 20 days before the plenary indulgence. On the day you want to gain a plenary indulgence, you can do 20 days before that or 20 days after that. But the communion should be most necessarily received on that day. So one confession is enough to suffice for many number of plenary indulgence. In a day, you can gain only one plenary indulgence. But as yesterday I told you, if you are at the point of death, you can gain a second plenary indulgence on the same day. And I told you the condition also yesterday, how you can gain that. Okay. Now, so you should receive communion and you should pray for the Holy Father's intent. If any of these conditions are missing, it will become partial. That indulgence will not be a plenary, but rather it will be partial indulgence. So I hope this is understood. Okay, and we should be free. One more condition. Free from attachment even to venial sins. That's why it is very, very difficult to gain a plenary indulgence. So at least in our heart, we should make a true repentance. That means we should not be attached. We should have love for God. We should have charity in our heart. Love for God. So then this condition will be fulfilled. Then only the indulgence becomes applicable. Or else the indulgence does not become applicable. Okay, now the code of canon law. Canon law means the official law or what you call the legal this thing of the church, how the church is governed. Okay, the law of the church. So canon law 996 says to be capable of gaining an indulgence, one must be baptized. So you have to be a baptized Catholic. You should not be excommunicated and you should be in the state of grace, as I told you, at the end of gaining the indulgence, prescribed work. So when you complete whatever work is given, maybe saying a rosary, saying, reading the Holy Scripture or doing the Stations of the Cross, all these are indulgence prayers. But that will be applicable only when you have in a state of grace. To gain indulgence, however capable subject must have at least the general intention. That means you should have the intention of acquiring them. As regards, so I hope this is very clear. So can a person in mortal sin obtain indulgences? No, absolutely not. He cannot. Okay. But rather only, as I told you, in the cases of this pandemic now, in extraordinary circumstances, the church gives a permission that I'm going to read out and tell you. So can indulgence be applied to others? No. Okay. So we cannot apply indulgence to others. So to obtain indulgence, now how can we obtain indulgences? As possible each day, we can obtain any number of partial indulgences. Any number.
plenary can be applicable only once in a day, but partial can be any number. So what we should do, it is a very good practice that on the beginning, when you say your morning prayer, you should remember, you should have a general intention to gaining there. So you should offer to the Lord that I want to gain as many possible indulgences in this day. So remember, even if you don't are not able to this thing, you can gain a partial indulgence. Okay. So, and we should have an intention, and we should recite one Our Father, one Hail Mary for the Holy Father's intention. So when we do this, automatically it will be, and we have to obviously perform that necessary work. Either it is saying a rosary, reading the scripture, adoration of the Blessed Sacrament, all these things gain indulgence. Okay. Can the indulgence be in other languages? Yes. If the prayer is permitted by the Holy Father, so who can grant? Only the Holy Father, except he can allow the bishop to give the indulgence. Okay. Otherwise, only the Holy Father has the permission to grant indulgence. And that is what is called the manual. So I have the new regulations on indulgences. So now we are going to see that. Now there are certain concessions, certain norms. So I'm going to read to you from the manual of indulgence. Now, please listen to this very carefully. This may be a little taxing to understand. Okay. What are the norms? I mean, what can we do? Okay. So listen to the norms very carefully for you, for us to understand. I already told you indulgence, gave you the definition of indulgence. Now, norm. Indulgence is partial or plenary according to whether it removes either part of the sin or all of the sin. The faithful can obtain partial or plenary indulgence for themselves, or they can apply. You can gain it for yourself or you can apply. I've already explained all these things. Now, supposing if the indulgence requires you to, you need to do a work, you need to go and visit a church. Like in the plenary indulgence, or what you call as pojangula indulgence, you need to visit your church. Or you can visit your church on the day of the feast. Supposing now St. John the Baptist Church, those who belong. So on the feast of 24th June, that is the feast of St. John the Baptist. So if you visit the church, you are supposed to recite one Our Father and one I Believe for the intentions of the Holy Father. So one Our Father, one I Believe. Then that indulgence becomes applicable for the sake of the church. Okay. Now, listen to this very carefully. Okay. Now, in the case of pandemic, what is applicable? To gain an indulgence, confessors, that means whoever is your confessor, can commute or he can remove. What can he remove? Either the prescribed work, means whatever indulgence work is there, or the conditions in favor of those for whom these are impossible. I mean, these are impossible to do because of what? A legitimate impediment. That means in simple language, now in this time of pandemic, we cannot go and perform these work. So your confessor, whomever you go to do confession, you can tell him that you have the intention to gain this indulgence. Then he can remove that work. That means whatever work. Now, supposing if the work is to go and visit the graves. Okay, the grave. But now if you are not allowed to go to visit the graveyard, then to your confessor, if you go for confession, so you can go and tell the confessor and you can say that you wanted to gain an indulgence. Okay, you had the intention of gaining the indulgence, then he can commute. He has the power to remove that prescribed work. That means to visit the graveyard. And to whatever to say the prayer. In the graveyard, you can say one Our Father, one Hail Mary for the intentions of the Holy Father and a prayer for the deceased. That is eternal rest grant unto them. So he can remove that work and he can remove the other conditions. Now, other conditions means confession and communion. But immediately when you have the chance after that, you have to do the confession and communion. So in the time of pandemic, you can be gain this indulgence. You can gain the plenary indulgence even now. But you have to, when the moment you get a chance to do your confession and receive communion, you have to tell the priest that you desire to gain the plenary indulgence. And every day from 1st to 8th, all the days are plenary indulgence, only applicable to the souls in purgatory, not to us, especially only for the souls in purgatory. So if you tell them, tell your confessor that you desired to gain these indulgence for the souls in purgatory, it will be applicable to you. So please understand. Now, norm number 25. It says that hierarchs or local ordinaries, which means bishops, okay, can grant permission to the faithful over whom they exercise authority and who live in places where it is impossible or at least very difficult. Now, due to pandemic, it is difficult to go to the confession or communion to gain a plenary indulgence. So we cannot go to confession, nor can we go for communion. So without confession and communion, provided that you have a true sorrow, that means for gaining this plenary indulgence, you should make an act of contrition. You can recite either Psalm 51, or we can say the normal act of, oh my God, forgive me. I mean, my God, I believe in thee, I hope in thee, I love thee above all things with all. So you can say an act of contrition. Okay, for their sins, and have the intention. You should have the intention of receiving these sacraments as soon as possible. So the moment you gain this act, that you have the act, desire to receive this sacrament, you will receive this plenary indulgence. So remember, you have to go to the confessor the moment. So you can now apply, you can have that intention. So from tomorrow beginning also, now what are these indulgence prayers? So I hope it is very clear. So partial, there are four grants. Four general concessions which are given. I will put it up on the group. I will read it out to you. A partial indulgence. Four grants are given. General grants to everyone. Indulgence. This is partial indulgence. Is granted to the Christian faithful. Means any of us who carrying out their duties and enduring whatever day-to-day your activities are and the hardships of life, raise their minds to God in humble trust to God and make at least mentally, that means mentally they pray some invocation. Now, what are the invocations? Short prayers. My God and my Lord. Okay. Jesus, Mary, Joseph, I love you. So these are all short invocations. So when you say these invocations with your daily exercising. So short prayers which you say, those prayers are given. I will send it to you on the group. So you will understand what are those invocations. Okay, so when you recite these prayers with bearing all the hardships of your life and raising your mind to God and mentally saying, you can gain a partial indulgence. Very simple. So if you have the intention and if without going for confession, without going for communion, you can gain the partial indulgence. But as I told you, the moment you get the chance to go for confession, you have to tell the confessor that you desired. Otherwise, this indulgence becomes invalid. So we have to understand this very clearly. Okay, so by this grant, the faithful are guided to fulfill the command of Christ, pray for others at all times. Okay, now the second grant, a partial indulgence is granted to the faithful who, led by the spirit of faith, give compassionately. So when you give of yourself, buy of their goods, whatever goods you have in your house, maybe temporal, material goods, spiritual goods, whatever are your material goods, if you give to others, okay, to serve their brothers in need, those who are in need of medicines, those who are in need of food, those who are in need of water, if you are giving to them, so this also can gain an indulgence. So these are what you call as works of mercy, spiritual and corporal works of mercy, to feed the hungry, to clothe, I already told you. So all these things, hungry, you gave me food, thirsty, you gave me drink, stranger, you welcome me. So this also can gain indulgence. Imagine. So you sitting at home can gain this indulgence, partial indulgence. Very simple. By you having by the spirit of faith. That means you have faith in God and you're giving of your goods for anyone in needs. That point of time you can gain. So this is the second grant. The third grant, a partial indulgence is granted to the Christian faithful when in a spirit of penance. Now we are belonging to the order of penance. SFO is order of penance. So listen very carefully to all the members of the SFO, even those who are vested and initiated. Voluntarily abstain. When you voluntarily abstain from something that is valid or permissible for you, if you give up food or you give up something which is most pleasing to you, that point of time you can gain an indulgence. That means you are mortifying. You are denying yourself. That is called as the mortification. You're abstaining from whatever is valid. What you can actually have without any sin, you can have that. So that point of time, when you deny a glass of water, I'm thirsty. I do not want to drink water. I deny myself of water. Then I can offer this for the souls in purgatory. That means that soul who has denied other people water, who has denied other people food, will gain the merit. So you can apply that for that soul in purgatory. So please understand how you can apply that. That means if that soul has denied somebody else food or it has denied somebody else water, that means some beggar has come, somebody has come and we have denied that. That point of time, that person who has not done that work of mercy, you can apply it to that soul. So please see how beautiful we have this chance. So when you are in this order of penance, the greatest opportunity is the third grant. The fourth general grant. A partial indulgence is granted to the Christian faithful who in particular circumstances of daily life, that means through your daily life, voluntarily give explicit witness. That means they bear witness for their faith. They tell others that they are Catholic and they profess their faith by outward sign. By doing the sign of the cross itself, you can gain in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, you can gain a partial indulgence. By saying the I believe, or before others, when we eat food, when we do the sign of the cross, we can gain a partial indulgence. So that's why I said in the morning, when we make our morning offering, we should say that we desire to gain all the indulgences applicable. So I hope this is very clear. 4 general grants. Now, so these all have scripture basis. Okay. All these are mentioned in the new regulations on indulgences. Okay. So these all have scripture references. Now, what about plenary indulgences? As I told you, 5 very important conditions are required. You need the performance of the work to which the indulgence is attached, like supposing rosary. Now, rosary, if you are saying in a family, in a group, like now we have the intercessory prayer group, rosary saying in our Padre Pio fraternity, we do this intercessory prayer. So that becomes an indulgence. When you offer it, when you say with any other person and you offer it, it becomes an indulgence. It becomes plenary indulgence. You can gain a plenary indulgence. Okay. But the second condition is sacramental confession. But I told you this can be commuted by your confessor. Okay, and Eucharistic communion, because this being a time of pandemic, prayer for the intentions of the Holy Father, this has to be said every day. So you can do spiritual communion, and then when you get a chance to do so the next moment you get a chance to do confession and communion, you have to go and tell your confessor, and then this becomes valid. Please understand this thing. Then your plenary indulgence becomes valid. So each day you can gain. How? By visiting the sacrament. Now, even if you are visiting the sacrament online, it becomes applicable, because now we can't go physically. So for half an hour, if you are adoring our Lord, you can gain a plenary indulgence. Every day, half an hour, if you are reading the Holy Scripture. So this is possible. Every day, if you are raising your mind by reading the Holy Scripture for half an hour, then you can gain a plenary indulgence. Okay, that means complete remission of the sins. So this can be applied, gained for yourself or for the Holy Soul. So that means those who did not read scripture in their lifetime and who are in purgatory, you can apply it for those souls. So please understand what all you can do. A plenary indulgence is granted to the one who does way of the cross. Now for the way of the cross, it has to be erected. That means in the church, you have to have properly the 14 stations erected. If we can't do that, then at least half an hour, you should meditate on the passion of Christ. Read from the Gospel of St. John or any other gospel connecting to the passion of Christ for half an hour, raising your mind to the sufferings of Jesus. So then also you can gain a plenary indulgence. A plenary indulgence is granted to one of the faithful who recites the rosary or at least 5 decades. You don't need to recite all the mysteries, all the joyful, sorrowful in one day. But even if you're reciting the mystery of that day, you can gain that in a public. That means in public, when now through the church, if you're reciting, so it becomes public. Okay. Or in your community, that means now we are a religious order. We are like an order. So SFO is an order. So you can gain the indulgence. Okay. Or in some pious association, like if you have joined the confraternity of the Holy Rosary, then you can gain this. If you are part of the confraternity, every day when you recite rosary, you gain the indulgences. So I hope. So then there are many, many other prayers which are there, which can gain indulgence. Okay. So when you receive the Pope. Now for the visit to the cemetery, that means from the 1st November to 8th November, all these days become applicable to the holy souls in purgatory. So there are many, many other prayers through which you can gain. Even now you are listening to this doctrine, that means the teaching of the Catholic Church, or you're listening to whatever I am saying about the indulgences, you can gain a partial indulgence. Okay, so I hope all these things are very, very clear. So I repeat, in your morning prayer, you can make a general intention that you desire to receive, partake of all the indulgences. You can recite one Our Father, one Hail Mary that time itself for the intentions of the Holy Father. Then in the day, you can recite either the rosary, scripture. You can do the passion, way of the cross by reading or meditating on the passions of Christ. You can adore our Lord via the online, or so all these things can gain plenary indulgence. So I hope this is very clear to us. So hope you all have understood. But as I told you, the condition is valid only if you go to your confessor. That means whenever you get a chance. So right now you can gain this. You can have the intention, and when you get a chance to do the confessor, you have to tell him that you had this desire to gain the indulgence, because only he can commute. he can pass. Otherwise, it will not be commuted. If you do not tell him this, it will not be commuted. I mean, he can remove that prescription of confession and communion. But that when you get a chance, you can do. So right now, you can have that intention. But the moment you get a... So this November, that is beginning from tomorrow when we begin the Navina, I will put it up on the group, on both the Friends of St. Francis as well as on the SFO formation group. I will put up the entire Navina by St. Alphonsus Liguori for the souls in purgatory. So you can begin doing all the 9 days and you can start praying. So remember, every day, all those who are doing the intercessory rosary also, I recommend to you very strongly to lift up. You can say, "Eternal rest grant to their souls, O Lord," and offer for the soul. So every rosary will become a powerful indulgence. Okay, so Manual of Indulgences is the book, name of the book. If you want, I will put up the PDF. It is a very big, this thing, you can see it's maybe around some 120 pages or something. Okay, so there are some norms there given. You can read that. You yourself can understand. A shorter version also I will put up, which will give you a simple understanding what plenary indulgence is, what a partial indulgence is, and all that I have taught today. So my dear brothers and sisters, let us help to empty purgatory. So by our penances, by our sacrifice. So remember, when you are doing some act of charity, please try. Now, indulgence is not something that, you know, you do it without love of God. Remember, anything, yes, even a family rosary is indulgence. Okay, because when you say two or three, saying the rosary also becomes an indulgence. So, but when we do it in an association, remember now, supposing if you belong to confraternity of Holy Rosary, if you join these confraternities, these were there. Now these things have been forgotten. There is something called a confraternity, or it is called Arch Confraternity of Rosary. Also, there is another means of gaining. You can offer 30 Gregorian Masses. Now, what are Gregorian Masses? Gregorian Masses are the Latin Masses, okay, which are offered in succession, one after another, for the deceased member. So when we give to any priest who's offering, there's a special altar. They are called, I mean, those indult. That means it is given a special altar. That altar has the privilege, only that on that altar, only masses for the souls in purgatory are offered every day. So that is called where 30 Gregor. So a single priest takes up that chance and he offers every day, one after another, 30 days continuous. So on the net, there are many this thing available. You can offer, pay the money for that, and they will offer for the deceased member. Only for one soul. You can offer for one soul. Or you can offer, you have to offer for a particular intention for that soul in purgatory. Okay. So the 30 Gregorian Masses. So the family rosary also is valid. Also the associations, or even the intercessory rosary, even the confraternity, if you have joined, if you belong to the Purgatorian Arch Confraternity, so there also these all gain indulgence. Even the SFO has indulgences. Every feast of the Franciscan belonging to the first order, second order, third order, you can gain an indulgence. That every day. So every day when you recite the rosary, but as I told you are not to be attached. Plenary indulgence means no attachment to venial sin. If you are attached to venial sin, that indulgence becomes partial. So at least we can gain partial indulgence. So in this time, so in normal conditions, I told you what will happen. But in the time of this pandemic, you can still gain. So you can have a good intention and a holy intention, and being properly disposed, you can gain many indulgences for your holy souls in purgatory. So hope, my dear brothers and sisters, you have got this complete understanding, and a small understanding, basically, not a complete understanding. These are very big, big topics which we can't summarize. Okay, it takes a lot of time to summarize. Then too, in whatever I could put it for you, I have tried to do and put it for you in a summarized way, what all these things mean, right? So the link for the Gregorian Masses I will put up for you, or I will also give you another this thing. I belong to what is called Purgatorian Arch Confraternity, which is located in, it's on an island, Papa Stronsi Island. Okay, so you can send, there they offer traditional Masses. Now, traditional Masses means the original Latin Mass. Not today how we are offering English Mass. That is called the Tridentine Mass. So there they offer everyday Latin Masses. So you gain all those indulgences. So maybe in the next session, I will show you that certificate, or I will click a pic of that and put it on that. The name of the... Now, one more thing. All of you can do one very good work. If you want to read more about purgatory, you can read a book called Read Me or Rue It. The first book is Manual of Indulgences. I will put it on the group. I will put, this is the official book of the church. Okay, not my teaching. It's the official book of the church. I will put it on the group. So don't worry. Then I will put something called as a primer of indulgences. You can please take your time, read it, understand. All your doubts and questions are explained on that. Every question and doubt is explained. The manual is a little heavy. You may understand, may not understand certain terms. There's another book written by Father Paul O'Sullivan. Okay, that is called Manual. Read Me or Rue It. Father Paul O'Sullivan. Okay, Father Paul O'Sullivan. Read Me or Rue It. So in this book, you will find many things, stories about in the purgatory and also how it is available on the net. It is available on the net. The second book I told you is Manual of Indulgences. You do not need to purchase this book. This book also is available on the internet, the PDF. I will send it on the group. If you are interested in reading, you can read it. Then there is a third called Primer. Primer of Indulgences. So I will put up that book also onto the group. Okay, and then I will put up the Novena to the Holy Souls in Purgatory. And the link for the Gregorian Masses, I will give it to you, or I will tell you about the Purgatory in Archconfraternity. With this, there is no other book beside the Manual of Indulgence. You do not need, if you want, you can have the Catechism. Catechism is available on EWTN or on the Vatican website. On Vatican website, the Catechism of the Catholic Church is there. You can go and see it. It's a very big document. So this is a small pocket-sized version. Otherwise, it comes in a red, hardbound, big version. Okay, that is called as the Catechism of the Catholic. You do not need, I'm already explaining to you. If you want, you can read and purchase it. Now you can order it online or whatsoever. Okay, so that is possible. So it's a very good thing to have Catechism of Catholic Church. What the church? And next thing is the Code of Canon Law. That is meant for priests. So you don't need to buy the Code of Canon Law. That's also a maroon color book. So you don't need to purchase that book. Okay, that is called Code of Canon Law. That is means how the laws of the church are governed. Like how the SFO also has a law. We have our statutes. We have our constitution. It has a provision. The law of the SFO. Similarly, there is a law of the church. Okay, that is called ecclesiastical law or church law. Okay, you don't need to purchase that book. So there are articles, I mean, how the confession is, how we need to, what, how the priest has to do, what the priest has to do. Then concerning for the SFO, Canon Law 303, it states certain things concerning the SFO or secular institutes, as we are called, or religious institutes. So all these things. So, yeah. So all these, even the souls, I mean, even the side of Don Bosco, they offer, they are called privilege altars, okay, where they offer only masses for the souls in purgatory. So those things are given. But now, according to the teaching of the church, every mass can be applied for the holy souls in purgatory. So hope you all have understood. It's already 10 o'clock. So may God bless all of you and grant you all the grace. So I think Brother Pascal has already put up the Vatican site for the Catechism of the Catholic Church. So you can refer to that on the SFO Regional Formation Group. He has done that. So thank you, Brother Pascal. So we thank you, all of you, for joining in. And I know it has been a long session, but you all have patiently come, joined and listened. So may God bless all of you. Let us help the poor souls in purgatory, and many, many stories and testimony. Many saints have become saints because of purgatory. Saint Peter, the patron saint, Saint Nicholas of Tolentino. He is the patron of the holy souls in purgatory. Saint Nicholas of Tolentino. Okay. Not the Saint Nicholas of Tolentino. He is the patron of holy souls in purgatory. Then there is a prayer of Saint Gertrude. You might have heard it. Eternal Father, I offer thee the most precious blood of the divine Son, our Lord, in atonement with all the souls, all the masses offered for all the holy souls in purgatory. So that prayer is there. I will put up that prayer also. You can recite that prayer also. So in this November month and every day, we can pray for the souls in purgatory. And definitely they will be grateful for us. We belong to, because nobody can pray for them. Remember, they can't pray for themselves. So only we are their last hope and source. Okay. Thank you, dear brothers and sisters, for patiently listening to me and joining in this session. May God bless us. We will continue on Tuesday. We will have the session where we will continue with the Article 3 of the I Believe. Good night and God bless you. With regard to the graveyard, you have to ask permission from your parish priest.